Chancellor, the news today is that unemployment has fallen by 44,000. By how much more would you expect it to fall as a result of the measures you've taken in your budget?
The budget mustn't be seen in isolation. The budget is a part of and a reinforcement of the economic policy we've been pursuing for some time. And that economic policy, of which the budget's a part, will, I think, see unemployment continuing to fall throughout this year. And the fall really is very encouraging. It's the biggest fall, that today's figures, the biggest fall ever recorded in a single month.
Lord Young was talking today about the fall of 20,000 a month average continuing. That means something like nearly a quarter of a million people off the dole in a year. Is that what you're predicting?
We're not predicting it. What I am predicting...
Forecasting?
What I am forecasting or predicting is that unemployment will continue to fall. The rate at which it has been falling over the past 7 months now is an average of over 20,000 a month, so that Lord Young's prediction, and it's a best guess, is by no means wild or unlikely.
And does that mean that quarter of a million is by no means unlikely by, say, the end of this year, the beginning of next year?
Could well be.
The opposition, both opposition parties, have between them described this reduction as a conjuring trick and cooking the books. And they say that because they think it's a result of the changes in the rules governing the rights to claim unemployment benefit and all the other special measures you've taken. Are you cooking the books?
No, of course not. And there'll be no virtue in cooking the books at all. The fall in unemployment is a result of two things. First of all, the special measures that we have taken, special measures to help the young through the youth training scheme and a number of other things to help with youth unemployment, which is now going down faster here than in any other country in Europe. And measures to help the long-term unemployed, the community programme, the restart counselling service, so that people are given advice on how helped to find jobs and are finding jobs. Those are the special measures. Then in addition to that, of course, there is the general growth of the economy. We're now the fastest growing economy in the Western world. And of course, that is creating new jobs.
Those new jobs, which have had much controversy around them, are very many of them, half, it's estimated, part-time jobs, which are perfectly valid jobs in themselves, but they are not the kind of full-time jobs that you need to replace in order to recover the position, are they?
Well, the part-time jobs are by and large going to women who actually prefer part-time employment because many of them have young children, and because of their family circumstances, part-time employment is actually much fits in with their lifestyle far better than a full-time job.
But would you would agree that they're not full-time jobs? That when you say a million jobs, you're talking about a very significant number of part-time jobs, not a million full pay packets going
right,
into the home.
But that's happening throughout the world. There is more and more a move to women in particular taking part-time work. So it's a mixture of things. It's full-time jobs in employment, in employees, part-time jobs which are particularly attractive to many women, married women particularly, and of course a tremendous growth in the amount of self-employment. That's a very big element in the figures.
Did you not have any inclination to act directly in your budget to stimulate employment, to create more jobs?
We now have a training, as I said in my budget speech, a programme of special employment and training measures which is unmatched anywhere in the world. And the latest instalment was announced only as recently as January by Lord Young. So there was no cause in this budget, which was about taxation, to do anything further on that front.
But you could have acted...
I think today's figures really prove that point.
But if you had acted on employers' national insurance contributions, if you had raised personal thresholds, would that not have stimulated the bottom end of the economy and brought potentially many more people into work than will be in work merely as a result of cutting taxes?
We'd already done both those things.
But you were playing with new money, weren't you?
As for the employers, we had completely abolished the national insurance surcharge, Labour's tax on jobs, at a cost of what is now, in today's money, £4,500 million. And we'd abolished that completely. I'd also reduced the national insurance contributions for those of the lowest paid, and also for people who are employing the lowest paid, to help there. And again, tax thresholds are something like 22%. More than they were when we came into office in real terms, 22% more over and above inflation. So that's been done. But what is necessary now is to create incentives, because that's what makes the economy tick, create incentives by cutting the amount of tax a man or woman has to pay on the extra pound they earn. And for 95% of the working population, that that extra pound is taxed at the basic rate. That's why it's so important to get that down.
Why did you set your face, Chancellor, against reducing the widening gap between what are called the haves and the have-nots, those who are in employment, in work, doing well, those at the bottom of the pile who are old, poor, unemployed? You could you not have used some of that money directly to reduce that gap?
As far as the pensioners are concerned, I'll just say two things. First of all, we have kept faith with the pensioners, increased the pension in line with the cost of living throughout our period of office, despite the fact that the total pensioner population has been growing all the time, grown very substantially, so that's been a very heavy burden, but we've paid that and we've gladly paid
that. But we're talking about a world, we're just on the pensioners
and the
thing.
Other thing, other than the pensioner,
yeah.
If you realise what was the real worry for the pensioner in the 70s, the real worry for the pensioner in the 70s was inflation. OK, they got their pension on a particular day, but then week after week, prices in the shops were going up and up and up and up and up, very faster and faster. And by bringing inflation down, we provided the biggest service we could to the pensioners and those on fixed incomes. As for the unemployed, we have got an unparalleled programme to help the unemployed, and we are getting the economy really moving, which is in the long run the most important thing. And that's why you see unemployment coming down so fast.
There's just one thing to go back to. I'll pick up on one or two of those in a moment. Come back to the pensioners. There's going to be an awful lot of hollow laughs around the hearth this evening hearing that, when they reflect that only, what, 6 weeks, 2 months ago, you were having to find emergency funds to stop old people dying of hypothermia. Now, that makes what you have done for the pensioners remarkably minimal, doesn't it?
No, it isn't. That's not so at all. And these were to help a small number of pensioners who were in difficulties in a period of exceptionally cold weather. There is another thing, too, of course, that not all pensioners, I realise, but a large number of pensioners get occupational pensions as well as the state pension. And occupational pensions have gone up very considerably.
You've predicted a growth rate of something around 3% this year. Productivity, as you've frequently said, is rising sharply, around 3%. Isn't it the case that you will not be able significantly to get rid of the unemployment figures while you have productivity rising at more or less the same rate as your output?
Now, again, I think that today's figures, and indeed the figures for the past 7 months, since July when the unemployment turned, they belie that, because we have been having this rapid productivity growth in manufacturing productivity. Throughout the whole of the 80s, our manufacturing productivity has been growing faster than any other of the major industrial countries. In the 60s, and indeed in the 70s too, we were bottom of the league, we're now top. And despite that, we now see unemployment going down, something like 150,000 down in the past 7 months.
We'll come onto that a little bit more later in the interview. Isn't it, though, rather eccentric to describe, as you did the other night, the economic performance of the last 2 years as a success story when you still have the level of unemployment that you are lumbered with at the moment?
No, unemployment's coming down, and there are a whole lot of other indications of success. The living standards of the people and our share of world trade, which is rising and has been rising for some years now when it used to be falling. Our productivity, which you yourself mentioned a moment ago. And I can tell you that
Productivity is measured, really, at the moment, so far, has been productivity on the shop floor has been measured essentially by the dole queues outside the factory.
No. It's quite true that what we did inherit was a grotesquely overmanned industry. And everybody knew, whichever political party they were in, everybody knew that overmanning was unsustainable because it was making us so inefficient we couldn't compete internationally. And that was a problem. We had to get rid of that. That overmanning had to go. And industry had to slim itself down, streamline itself, so it could compete successfully. And that's what it's doing in world markets. And wherever you go in the world today, that is recognised. The British economy is now in a stronger position than it's ever been before.
In your budget speech, Chancellor, you said, I'm quoting here, it remains the prime objective to keep inflation on an underlying downward trend. Mm. Inflation's set to rise. How can inflation, which is going up, really be coming down?
Well, it never goes in a straight line. That's what happens. What is going to happen this year is it's at the moment about, what, 3.9%. I reckon it's going to go up in the middle of the year to about 4.5% or thereabouts, and then come down to 4% by the end of the year. That's my forecast. And then it'll carry on going down. You see...
It'll carry on going down. Is it still
your
objective...
In the medium term, yes, certainly.
...to reach zero?
Absolutely, yes.
You intend to reach zero?
I intend to reach stable prices. That is the ultimate objective.
Because many of your most severe critics believe that you've given up, that you were once a radical reforming chancellor, and in fact you've just become a sort of closet Keynesian in the meantime. They say that you've abandoned the goal of zero inflation, and the evidence of it is that you no longer seem to be very concerned about the money supply M3.
No, I've not changed at all. And as for the money supply M3, that is part of a wider picture, which is really, in simple terms, maintaining financial discipline. Any business goes bust if it doesn't have financial discipline. In the same way, if a country doesn't have financial discipline, that country's economy goes all wrong. And one of the signs of that are rampant inflation. And that's what we had. You talk about whether 4.5% going up. Do you know what the average rate of inflation was during the whole of the lifetime of the last Labour government? 15.5%.
But your inflation rate at the moment is considerably higher than most of your rivals in Europe and in the OECD.
That's right, because they all got the benefit of the fall in the oil price. For us, as an oil producer, unlike them, for us as a major oil producer, a major oil exporter, it was as broad as it was long. It wasn't pure benefit. So they were able to get pure gain, and for us, as they cut both ways.
Is it financial control to have some £40 billion floating around in consumer credit? Consumer credit growing, what is it, about 10% a year? And the prospect with more tax cuts of imports coming in, is that control of finance?
Yes.
In the terms of which monetarists mean it?
And nothing,
you have meant it in the past?
Yes, there's nothing wrong with people buying cars on their hire purchase or buying... homes on the mortgage. The vast majority of the consumer credit which you're talking about is in fact mortgages. It is people buying homes on mortgages. And we have encouraged the growth of home ownership, and I'm very glad indeed that there are now 2.5 million more people owning their own homes than when we first took office.
Very briefly, Chancellor, is it your intention to, if you remain as Chancellor, to get taxes down at basic rate from 25% down to 20%, down to the American rates of 15%? Is that a goal of yours?
Well, let's first get to 25%. We're not there yet. We're very close to it. When we took office, the basic rate of tax for everybody was 33%. We've already got it down first to 30%, then to 29%, and now, in this week's budget, down to 27%. I still am determined to get it down to 25%. Once we've got there, which I'm confident we shall, then we'll have to see where we go from there.
Do you aspire to the American levels?
The Americans have a much smaller public expenditure as a proportion of their GDP, and so that it is not realistic, while there is that difference in public expenditure, to have American rates of taxation. But we can certainly get our taxation down, and I believe we steadily shall.
On that rather guarded answer, Chancellor, can we just pause there a moment, perhaps get a clearer perspective on some of those facts and figures that we've been talking about, if you don't mind? As the background against which to assess the Chancellor's strategy in the budget, it's perhaps worth having a brief reminder of how Britain has performed over the last 8 years, especially in comparison with our major rivals like America, Germany and Japan. But bear in mind the sharp recession at the start of that period, which makes some difference to those figures.
In 1979, when the government came into office, unemployment in Britain stood at just over 1 million, around 5% of the workforce. Since then, it's risen by over 2 million. At the end of last year, it stood at over 3 million, or 13%, though that figure's now fallen slightly. Over the same period, the average of all the leading industrial nations, our fellow members of the OECD, rose from the same 5% to just 8%, significantly lower than the British figures. In 1979, inflation in Britain was just over 13%. After a sharp rise in 1980, it fell to just under 3.5% in 1986, though the trend is now up again. Meanwhile, the OECD nations as a whole began with inflation at just under 10%. They too fell, but even further, to just over 2.5%. Between 1979 and 1986, Britain's gross domestic product, our total output, rose by a total of 9.5%, while the OECD figure rose by no less than 16%. However, the British economy is now beginning to grow at a similar, even a faster rate than our competitors. There is, though, a big gap to close. If, for instance, you take industrial production over the last 8 years, the increase in Britain was 3%, while the OECD nations as a whole averaged 11%, almost four times higher. And for manufacturing industry alone, the gap is just as wide. British output fell sharply from 1979 and is still over 5% below the level of 8 years ago. In the same period, manufacturing output in the OECD nations also fell, but only slightly, and is now 13% up on the 1979 figure.
Chancellor, given that background, isn't it somewhat massaging the facts to describe Britain as one of the strongest industrial nations, as you did?
No, I think those charts were all very carefully massaged by the choice of the sectors of the economy and by the choice of the base date, because you can say that 79 is a perfectly reasonable base date to take for Britain, but of course it has no particular significance for the other economies, because it was the peak of a cycle for Britain. It wasn't the peak of the cycle for the other economies. So what I did in the budget broadcast, which some of your viewers at home may have seen, was I, to be completely impartial, I just took the decades, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, and I think that gives a fairer picture.
Well, if I can just on that say that most economists don't, they tend when they do to go from peak, you go from peak to peak.
Yeah, but different countries had different peaks.
In your
peak,
surely,
but that wasn't the peak for Britain that you started from, but not the peak for the other countries.
I don't want to get into a long thing on this, but also in your figures, you tend to go from the bottom of the trough when you would expect to get a much greater increase up to where you are now.
No, I didn't actually take the bottom of the trough. The bottom of the trough was 1981. What I actually took was, to say, the decades, the 60s, the 70s, and the 80s.
Well, let's leave that one there, because I think economists could argue over that for a very long time. Let me ask you this, given that background, whichever it is, do you regard manufacturing exporters as crucial to Britain's future prosperity?
Certainly, and they're doing very well. And I'm glad to say that the manufacturing industry has made itself much more efficient than it was before. And as a result, our share of world trade in manufacturers has been rising steadily now for the past 5 or 6 years, whereas it previously had been falling for decades.
And yet you are projecting for next year on manufactured exports, I think, a deficit of £8 billion. Is that something that you can indefinitely tolerate?
We don't have only manufacturing industry. We either have very important parts of industry. I mean, I don't know whether Thames Television sells programmes abroad, I suspect.
It does its best, and occasionally it succeeds. Best. Well, in fact, it succeeds a great deal, I
Well,
say.
Good, I congratulate you. Well, that's a valuable export, but it's not manufacturing. In fact, that's known as an invisible export, and we're particularly good at that.
But manufacturing exports do make up... Manufacturing does make up 75%, Chancellor.
You've got to look at the picture as a whole. You've got to look at the picture as a whole. And we are now in deficit. We had £1 billion deficit on the current account last year, and we'll probably have £2.5 billion deficit next year. But you have to look at that in perspective. Over the previous years, we had a cumulative surplus of £20 billion, and our stock of net overseas assets now is well over £100 billion, bigger than any other country in the world, with the exception of Japan. So the problem of financing a temporary period of deficit is no problem at all.
Ah, you say a temporary period of deficit.
Yes.
Do you expect it to come back into the black after next year or the year after?
Oh, it will. I'm sure it'll come back into equilibrium. I can't predict precisely when. If you look at the forecast that I put out at the time of the budget, it was a smaller rate of deficit in the first half of next year, 88, and that's as far ahead as we forecast.
Can I pursue this question of manufacturing industry a bit further? Because of its importance, at least in exports, providing 75% of our exports, when, as is inevitable, the oil runs out, which produces a small but significant proportion of our export wealth, what's going to fill the gap if manufacturing exports don't expand to fill that gap?
Well, the whole of non-oil exports, but this is not a hypothetical question. We have already lost, as a result of the collapse in the oil price, we've already lost half the value of our oil exports. We lost that almost overnight, lost £4 billion worth of oil trade. And the fact that we were able to take that in our stride is, I think, a tribute to the underlying strength of the British economy.
At the moment, Chancellor, your government, whether through its own cause or for whatever reason, is presiding over the brain drain of 1,000 scientists and technologists a year. Between 83 and 85, there was a fall of 30,000 people working in research in the private sector. If Britain's to remain in the first division, haven't you got to act directly to reverse that trend?
A lot of people are coming back. It's true that people are going overseas, but a lot of people are coming back. A lot of people who went out during the Labour government, period of Labour government, talented people, are now coming back. But I think that is a good point, and I think that one of the things one has to look at is the rates of tax in the United States and the rates of tax here, because that is one of the factors that can lead to a brain drain.
But all the reports coming out from the House of Lords, from the industry themselves, say it's not to do with the tax rates. What's worrying them is the absence of resources, the falling standards, the inability to get the right kind of equipment. It's the loss of morale which is driving people abroad more than the loss of money.
We spend very substantially as a government on research and development in this country. In fact, we spend roughly the same, a slightly different way, but we spend roughly the same in total as our major European competitors.
Well, I wouldn't
where
like to
we,
get it...
Where we spend less, and it's quite true where we do, is the British industry spends less on research and development than the private industry in these other countries. And I would like to see British industry, now it is so much more profitable, but it used to be so unprofitable it couldn't afford. But now it is so much more profitable, I would like to see British industry spend more on research and development.
Chancellor, can you give any assurance to reluctant investors in manufacturing that you are going to make sure, insofar as you can, that the pound does not rise above its present level on the exchange markets, which they already think to be uncomfortably high?
I don't think they do. I think there was a time when they thought that the rate was uncomfortably high. But I think that they're very satisfied with the present rate.
I'm sure you'll have some letters tomorrow morning from them saying, on the contrary.
Well, you can never satisfy everybody, Jonathan. But I think that that they are generally satisfied with the present rate. And you saw that the president of the CBI, David Nixon, who is a very successful businessman in his own right, is satisfied with the policy we've been pursuing. But I have made it absolutely clear that I do not want to see the pound go through the roof. And one of the reasons why I was very happy to take part in the agreement with the finance ministers of five other countries, six were invited, but in fact only five turned up, five other countries in Paris last month, to try and achieve a period of exchange rate stability, was precisely because I think it is in the interest of British industry.
One of those countries, I think, was Italy, which walked out because they were only invited to the coffee. But anyway, leave that on side for a second. Is it true that what is often thought, that you agree that £1.60 to the dollar was the kind of rate that was a maximum rate for the pound?
I think you mean $1.60 to the
pound. I said $1.60 to the pound.
But now, I have never quoted a figure, but I think that the present level of exchange rates, both against the dollar and against the Deutschmark, which is really rather more important these days for British manufacturing industry, I think it is round about right.
Chancellor, there are already some analysts talking of a new world recession around the corner and saying that they believe you worry about that as well. They fear a deepening balance of payments problem as a result of that in Britain, with all that implies. Threat to the pound, tightening of belt again, increase in unemployment, and another cycle of deeper recession. Do you ever have that nightmare yourself?
There are always problems, and I warned about them in my budget speech. I think provided there is a continuation of the policies we're pursuing in this country, which means a continuation of the present government after the election, whenever that may be, then I think the British economy will be all right from the internal angle. But there is, as you rightly say, a problem of a world recession. I think that the odds are against that happening. And one of the reasons, again, for the meeting of the finance ministers of all the leading countries and the central bank governors of the leading countries in Paris last month was to try and ensure that it didn't happen. And we are cooperating much more closely. There is a danger, but I think that the odds are against it.
Briefly and finally, Chancellor, if the Conservatives, if they were to win the next election, would you, assuming you had the choice, wish to stay in your present post or move on?
Well, that's entirely a matter for the Prime Minister. It's not a matter for me.
That's why I said it was your own choice. If you had the choice, would you prefer to stay?
Yes. Now, I'm content with what I'm doing. There's a lot still to be done.
Would you like the election to get rid of the fever that you don't like to be in June?
The main point of an election is to win it. That is rather more important than the precise date.
I thought you might say something like that. Chancellor, thank you very much. That's all from this week for tonight.